I like to draw invisible objects from nature. This is just to make you pay attention. This is a nonsense phrase, which I like. This is how I work, by the way. And I'm sure 99% of you work the same way. Drawing. So I'm starting to talk about drawing like everybody else. But actually, everybody else already said what I'm going to say now. They already said it before me, so this is a little bit double up. Drawing is talking, it explains, it forms an idea, explores possibilities. Paul Klee took a line for a walk. Saul Steinberg is the missing link between writing and drawing. He said drawing is reasoning on paper. Matthias Falbakken adds, and that's a Norwegian writer, and he's hated by most people. He said, I hate the fact that everything, every fucking thing, every action, every fucking attitude, every rebellion and every indecency, everything turns into design sooner or later. So I'm going to make, I make cartoons, caricatures, watercolors and models. And it's a form of communication like no other. Writing can not make you laugh together about different things, but images can. So, you just proved it this when I started. How do I do this? Yeah. I just this. Okay. So, I had to make some cartoons for Freeze. For Freeze. It's a bit anti-freeze. So, this is the element. We didn't use this card, but it's sort of a blind card project that people buy cards and they don't know who did them. And they're desperately hoping it's somebody really famous. So they're all very disappointed when they turn the card around. These are the pictures I made for that, and I didn't use them all. I used just two of these. These are just stupid little drawings that I just make just to amuse myself. They're all very... And this is, of course, Saul Steinberg, who is the perfect, that's why I'm calling him the missing link between writing and drawing. He draws writing. And this is very funny, one of his funny cartoons. So it's a way to create stories as the equivalent of writing. Saul Steinberg said, the continuous line of my drawing dates from childhood, and it's probably a way of writing from my illiterate days. For me, it's a way to a story, a narrative. I call a narrative always a story, but everybody else calls it a narrative. And for me, stories are crucial to everything I draw. As in architecture, there has to be a scenario, otherwise it will be an empty gesture, form of posturing. So the reasons for Darwin's drawings, when he drew an orchid, that was one of his passions, orchids, was not to make a picture, but was to get a deeper understanding of it. Drawing is an important way of a botanist to feel the way into a plant, as British orchidologists. It's people who study orchids are called orchidologists. Phil Crabb. So now I'll show you. This is, I don't know why this is there. For Da Vinci, it was a way to understand the mechanics of everything, to understand and instruct. And I make objects that start with a drawing, fold them and turn them into sculpture, which I find useful to starting to think in three dimensions. I made many cardboard objects starting out by drawing the shape from all sides. Now I will show you some work and stories behind them. And this is a mind game that I invented, which spontaneously happened when I had a little wall on my drawing table, and I put some objects, because I have a lot of objects, and I put some objects in it, and people who came into my room started to change it and put other objects in, and I thought, wow, that is so typical that they did that. So I started to ask everybody who came into my studio to put objects in that room. And so that's how this started to make this mind game, that everybody has to put objects in a room and then they can be analyzed by everybody around them, and they can analyze them according to their own non-Freudian thinking, or Freudian, or whoever thought of analyzing. And these are the objects that I put in it, but they could make and add, if they had this game, they could add more objects or according to their own system of thinking. And I made them enlarge for an exhibition in the AA to have something to show. And it was all I had, was a lot of rubble from my studio. So I made this mind game in big, and I took it to different countries, to different exhibitions. And everybody made their own system of, you know, putting things together, and everybody else would analyze them and say, this is so typical for you that you did that. And here are children, and children were amazing. This was in Basel exhibition, and the children were the ones who always had a concept and stories. So they always had a reason to put things in a certain way, although grown-ups were always saying, oh, that will look funny, let's do this. But they had a very, very structured way of wanting special things be together with other things. So it was very revealing about how children think and how this children are, in a way, more serious about what they do than and know what they're doing. That's a revealing. So here are some people who manipulated the places in the AA. And this is the AA, and there you see all the objects that I collected and the photographs. Now this is, we did an exhibition about Lina Bobardi, and she always has, like in your picture, a pointing hands in every drawing. She has hands that point. So I thought, for this exhibition, I have to make a hand. And I made thousands of models, and it never looked like a hand until I had this model. And then I could fold it. I looked at all the, made a lot of drawings. And then I folded them into these hands. And I made a lamp out of it. And I made this dancing people. I wanted to make from a drawing three-dimensional objects. So firstly I made it a flat surface, drew the people on and then folded them. And they suddenly, spontaneously started to dance the tango. Object, it's all out of paper. This was for thing for a Brazilian fundraising for children who play football. And this was as well, we had to make a whole city of London. They all got stolen, by the way. This was a fish for one of the objects in the rooms. This was the man when he was still cardboard and not painted. So you can see cardboard, you can make grooves at the back and then fold it, and it will look like it's wood, carved wood. And here are the hands in an exhibition in Istanbul, the Biennale, where as I got obsessed with hand movements and with doing things with hands, and so I was propagating drawing and the importance of hands. This was for Biennale in Rotterdam, where I this case Christians, I made a chess game out of very strange stuff. We were quite inhibited by the way the machine was working. It was an enormous machine, and it had one little thing that could do this. But you could put your drawings in, and it could make it. But you had to make it so that the machine could make it. So we were restricted in that you couldn't have square windows, so that everything is round. And it's another object of cardboard. This was for a Lina Bobardi exhibition. These were the, it's a bit messed up, this whole thing, but anyway, not chronological at all. And these are all the devils I made for the Lina Bobardi exhibition. This was the model for those devils, a metal thing that we found in a market in Brazil, in Bahia. And these are the objects I made after that. And here are two people playing the mind game in the exhibition in Lausanne, in the Macintosh, gallery, Macintosh. And here is the first game that I made. You see them play it, and they have eyes, eyes that give light. And you can turn, you take the hair off, and you can put the light on, and you can put the hair back on. All made out of cardboard and gum strip. Now, this is another thing. So, this is the importance of metaphors in thought and speech. Metaphors are something we can use unconsciously and on an everyday basis, and we do deploy them in everyday speech and in thought. In speech, you utter about 6 metaphors per minute. James Geary, a well-known analogist and writer of the book, I is another, the secret life of metaphor and how it shapes the way we see the world. He says that the metaphorical thinking is essential to how we understand ourselves and others, and how we communicate, learn, and discover and invent. When it comes to thinking, metaphors superbly assist us by dealing with anything abstract. Ideas, emotions, feelings, concepts, thoughts, we inevitably resort to metaphor. A metaphor is comparing, it's understanding the unknown. Metaphor is basically comparing two entirely dissimilar things. And symbols are coded shortcuts to meaning. They help us to understand the unknown, like our ancestors, my English is terrible, looking with bemused wonder at the stars of the night sky. We try to understand the sky by naming everything we saw, so that's why we ended up with bears, fishes, virgins, arches, etc. Metaphors are everywhere, but they are hidden in our language. They are everywhere in the words we use. Ralph Waldo Emerson described language as fossil poetry. So a metaphor in art is constantly deployed in art. Take, for instance, surrealism. Surrealism pulls the whole metaphor into a personal narrative. And I will be looking to pull personal narratives from you later, tomorrow, the workshop. There's jokes have a special mechanism. I want to give you one example of a joke which I particularly like because of the twist in the story. A man goes to a library and he asked the woman who's standing at the desk, he says, "Can I have fish and chips, please?" And she says, "Sorry, we are a library." And he says, "Oh, I'm so sorry. Can I have fish and chips, please?" So, you have to sort of a journey through several rooms in your mind to follow this narrative. From the library to the fish and chip shop, and then after the whole sequence of steps away from the origin of the story, you have to then to retrace your steps back to the library. The delayed understanding provides for the eventual humor in the joke, as the mind catches up whilst retracing through the various chambers of meaning. Because we predict using models, values and other rules, humor works by breaking such expectations, inducing metaphor patterns. This induces includes reviewing different interpretations of what had just happened and the selection of option which seems to fit best. The delay can be very short as we quickly make sense of what it said. And it can't take several seconds, it can, or need some verbal explanation. The best jokes often have a delay around a second before realization kicks in. Now I'm going to talk about the mind, how the mind is a sort of an amazing sort of way of surviving. There was a man who lived in a cupboard, Brian Keenan. He's an Irish writer who was captured by Islamic Jihad. He spent 4.5 years in a cupboard as a hostage in Beirut. Then he wrote a book about his experience called An Evil Cradling. He describes how he was forcibly locked in a closet for the majority of the time, and he kept his sanity by through the whole epic ordeal, just imagining, year on year, sitting in the cupboard by inventing a daily routine. He imagined he would step out of his cupboard, walk along a path through to a grand house with many rooms. He would then go through all these rooms one by one and created a different interior in every room and make changes every day, and this would take him all day. After he completed every room, at the end of the day, he would leave, mention, and walk back and come back into his closet. So Keenan's experience showed that through acts of the imagination, we can travel a journey to anywhere we want to go. Imagination is a safekeeper of our identity. This is how he kept totally sane, basically. People are deprived of sensory stimulus, for example, in an extreme hostage situation, will call on the imagination and memory of the means to confirm why they are to themselves and in order to stay sane. Sorry. I find reading such a... am I too late? Is it too long? Oh, what did I do?
I went to sleep.
Sorry. I'm sure everybody is going to sleep by now as well.
I thought it was really good.
Was it?
Yeah, it was really good timing.
Good. Now, everybody woke up? We are all artists. We're all architects from the start. When we become artists, we prolong our childhood, often indefinitely. For artists, it's easier than architects, who get bogged down with the logistics, as you've shown here, of actually building and the intrusion of multiple egos. But the need to control grows. So, is this getting too long?
No.
How long have we got?
5 or 10 more minutes.
5-10 minutes. You have a standard. So it's 5 to 10 minutes. I only have one more page.
That's right. Okay. That's good.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I start all over again. Living in the Matrix. Why did I have this picture here? Maybe I should go to the next page so we don't get, doesn't go to sleep. Living in the matrix of symbols and metaphors. Symbols are man's ancient way of ordering a chaotic array of different experiences, simulating to his particular life or destiny. The way we interpret most of what we see in our daily existence is through unconscious metaphors and symbols. Only a small percentage of our reality is unaffected by this kind of cushioning lens. And so, as a consequence, in turn, we can explain a lot of what we say and see with metaphors. For instance, you might say to yourself or to a friend that the boy or girl is hot. And so this is a metaphorical way of explaining a concept of attraction, an idea, a relative to a physical being in front of you. You don't say he's wearing a beautiful red dress and I find this beautiful, or a similar linear description. So we communicate everyday feelings in metaphors and symbolic analogies. The conscious ego and the unconscious self complement each other and actually fit perfectly once brought together. By gradually integrating conscious with unconscious content in the psyche, we order and affect the efficiency and quality of our personal life, bringing value and meaning to it. Metaphors and symbols have always been treasured as releasing creativity from the unconscious. In the modern information age era, we are constantly blasted, I'm going to the next one before it goes to sleep again, blasted by metaphors and symbols. So this, I suppose, is all metaphors and symbols. Through advertising and digital programs and applications, our waking lives are full of mystery on an unconscious level, and yet our imagination needs to be fed with experiences which are stored in our memories, reflected on. And then we can add them to what, as we call them up, and examine them and incorporate them in a creative way. While James Geary expounded on the secret life of metaphor, I will show you the secret life of buildings, metaphors for human relationships. So this is the meaning, this is the reason I have this New York. This was the storyboard for an animation film that I made for French television. This is my friend Terry Wayne Benoosh, very, very early on, 84 maybe, I don't know this exact date. And this was the storyboard. That was all the, that was the dirty bit. And this was a set for behind the for them to use in behind the play, the animation. So, what the workshop task, I would think, this is the book which was published with the AA exhibition. And this is, I want to show you what I would like to do in the workshop is creating chambers of the mind. So our workshop will take a journey into the imagination, creating a metaphorical room for each of you, which will reflect and represent your incredible talent, your horrendous failures, your ambitions, your unconscious desires, your future. In short, your secret life, thrown right into the open. So we all have to be deeply serious about play. And I would like to, you have to reflect on who you are, and if you don't know, ask the person sitting next to you. They will tell you exactly. So that's what I would like to do. Here's a few things. This is this was for a project where all the dead people of the world would be into pyramids, which would grow bigger and bigger and bigger. For next project, and this was for rooms in the that thing in the museum, in the Guggenheim Museum, the in the middle, there's a word for it, but I've forgotten it now.
Atrium?
No. We called it something else, but anyway, that was a project. Everybody had to think of something to do in the room, and I called it an idol tower, but everybody had to make a room for the person they admired most. Of course, all the people I asked to make a room, they didn't do it, except for one. These are some of my rooms. This was for project for Thalys going from Amsterdam to Paris. I did landscape of the old paintings from three countries, Holland, Belgium, and France. And I put all the toys and souvenirs that were from those countries on top. So there was something to enjoy for grown-ups and children. And this is a picture of my room, but very sanitized, I can tell you that. And this was for this Lausanne exhibition, Rooms for Thought. And this was the Thalys with this frieze in it. And this is another rooms that I created in my house. Probably we had that already, kids. And this is collaboration with Rem Koolhaas for Captive Globe. And this was basically Captive Globe revisited for Charles Jenks' book. And this is another room. I think that's the end, yeah.